Living on a military base in 1990, 5 miles from the nearest town in Sicily, there was very little interaction with the local Italian population, and since the base was scheduled to close within 2 years, the number of military personnel was dropping, and with it, the number of kids with which to form friendships. Having already been pulled out of public schools to go to a super small private Christian school through 4th and 5th grade back in the States, looking back, I can already see the cracks in my psyche when it came to confidence, worth, and social ability. Then about halfway through 6th grade, my mom pulled my two sisters and me out of the Dodd school we were attending on base and decided to homeschool us. Writing back to our old pastor, my mom found a curriculum that would serve to stop the flow of actual knowledge into our brains and continue the dogmatic teachings she had begun a few years earlier. The end goal was for my dad to get restationed back in Ohio so that we could attend the same private Christian school that our old pastor's kids went to. Ensuring we spent enough time learning about the basics of math, history, and cherry-picked science, our coursework also included daily devotionals, Bible readings, and grade school-level theology. I remember reading a biography on Isaac Newton and wishing that I had been a sickly child, since all of the biographies I had read thus far started with a sickly child that went on to do great things. I was, of course, joking, but my mom always told me, "Don't say that. There's power in your words." Luckily, since my parents pulled us out of school halfway through the year, I had already made some friends, and the slow influx of personnel to the base for different closing duties meant that there were still a few new friends to be made, and I spent most of my time at the base youth center. There, we were casually supervised by some of the moms that worked there, and we were mostly free to do whatever we wanted in regards to bike riding, skateboarding, sports, music, food, arcade games, and movies. I remember listening to the Sex Pistols, Bell Biv DeVoe, Madonna, Janet Jackson, Poison, Vanilla Ice, and MC Hammer all for the first time while I was there. I'm sure my mom came down to the youth center a couple of times just to make sure it was a good environment, and apparently she visited on a particularly boring day. While my first attempt at a kiss had been in kindergarten, the youth center is where I had my first real kiss, and I learned a little bit about sex and came as close to popular as I could, given the 8-hour absence by being home all day and not being with the other kids at school. I was an intelligent child, and I normally finished my work a couple hours early, so I took up a job as a paperboy and delivered the military newspaper, Stars and Stripes, every day for about a year. This helped me buy all of those G.I. Joes I mentioned in part one of the series. Around this time, my mom was adopting more and more dogma and random teachings in regards to bringing up a child in the way they should go, and I remember the conversation about expletives being particularly humorous. In an attempt to keep us from cursing, my mom insisted that we say nothing instead of saying something inflammatory. I remember saying fiddlesticks once after stubbing my toe, and being told that if I was gonna say that, well, I might as well just say fuck. Jeez was taking the Lord's name in vain because it was short for Jesus. Shoot was just a different version of shit. Darn was a different version of damn, etc. I can honestly say that until I was 13, I didn't say a single curse word, and my first one was fuck. Well, of course, that's all by the majority of other people's standards, but in my house, you had to worry about everything, because I remember playing Super Mario Brothers in the living room with my dad one day, and I was particularly far and running out of lives, and I died one last time, and I said, crap. And I turned around, whipped my head at my dad to make sure that he didn't hear, or to make sure I wasn't going to die. And, well, he didn't even react. Which of course gives a good view of the differences between what my mom thought was important and what my dad could kind of care less about. Too soon, in my opinion, my dad's assignment was over and we packed our things, sent them on ahead, and lived the last couple of months in the temporary housing. By this time, I had finished another full year of homeschooling and we were headed back to Ohio to start school at the private Christian school from which we had received our last year and a half's worth of curriculum. At this point in my life, from kindergarten to 7th grade, counting homeschool on the list, I'd been in 7 different schools, and if you throw in preschool for giggles, that number becomes 10. I used to think that this change of surroundings created a person that was able to make friends easily and not be overwhelmed with the surroundings, but I was wrong. When I started going to my new middle school, I was already at a disadvantage because we started about a month into the school year, so the new kids had already found friends, and I was a bit awkward and in the middle of my last growth spurt. Hell, I'll go ahead and say it. I was a dork. Most of it was fashion, some of it was looks, and a lot of it was just not knowing what the hell to do surrounded by so many kids that had known each other for most of their lives. I was used to kids that had 10 different sets of friends from all the places their parents had moved them through, and now suddenly, I was forced to find the clique that would accept me as their own. I spent a lot of time seeking out the 2 people that I knew from my church and hoping they wouldn't be embarrassed to be seen with me. My self-confidence went down the drain, and my worth wouldn't have been enough for a piece of bubblegum. It wasn't a good time, and I don't look back on it fondly. My journal entries from that time period show a very confused, lonely, and impotent boy that couldn't understand how the civilian life worked and how to break through to these seemingly uncaring kids. It hurts to think about this kid. With his new glasses, his new braces, and 5 new pimples a day, having to seek out just an acquaintance at lunch and hope that someone might talk to him so he can have a real conversation and be a part of something other than his own misery. My 8th grade English teacher was so diehard in her religious beliefs that before we learned about anything having to do with grammar or literature each day, she had to give us some new information concerning the proofs of the Bible's authenticity. I remember one day in particular, she told us of a drilling operation that had drilled straight into hell and that the screams of the souls were audible from this new hole. She believed it, she warned us all about the reality of hell proven by the drilling team, and then she turned to vocabulary and sentence structure. No one even batted an eye, and I could only sit there and wonder where people get this shit. In my inability to deal with my new surroundings and seeing the lack of practicing Jesus' teachings going on all around me in the form of gossip, deceit, and dishonesty, I was already becoming a skeptic. It could be said that we were just kids and the actions of children shouldn't be taken as the way the whole world works, but I was under the impression at the time that I was in a Christian environment. There was no instruction from the teachers or administration concerning the immaturity and mimicry of what I had already seen in the church, and I had to wonder why no one was doing something to create a less hostile environment when we were supposed to be the ones that were better and chosen. Seeing as I still get newsletters from my school asking for money, I'm leaning towards the idea that they aren't in the business of education for its gains through inspiration and educating young people, but, like so many others, for the money. 9th grade moved me to the high school where both of my sisters were upperclassmen, and I was immediately given a bit more attention as their little brother. Friends of my sisters suddenly became my friends, and there was a brief period where the glasses, braces, and acne didn't hinder my social status. But still, within my own grade, I was considered standoffish, strange, and mysterious. Of course, to me, I thought I was just shy, awkward, and confused, and those around me couldn't get through to me because so very few of them tried. I spent most of my time outside of school just watching TV as my mom's standards on what I could watch lowered dramatically when she realized I wasn't the happy, cheerful child that she thought I was, and if I wasn't watching TV, I would be in my room, locked away from all family interaction other than dinner. My only friends were friends from our small church, and after a time, my parents tried to get me to find friends at school, but my argument was that they decided to keep going to a church that I had one classmate in instead of another church that had 10 or maybe even 20 classmates. Add that to the fact that all of my acquaintances at school lived too far away to walk and I wasn't old enough to drive yet. They looked into the other church I suggested and after a cursory examination decided that it would be better for me to have zero to very few friends than to receive Christian doctrine that they didn't agree with. Note that this other church was mostly Baptist and we were non-denominational Pentecostal. Of course, in hindsight, this is hypocritical because the Christian school's Bible classes weren't lining up with what we were learning in church either. So, logically speaking, they should have pulled us out of the school as well, but I guess they figured it was better to have similar, but not exact, teachings while in school other than no teachings at all about the Bible in a public school. 9th grade is also where I saw the first cracks in the foundation of the Christian faith and belief system. In Bible class, we were talking about the authenticity of the Bible and how we could know it was true and accurate. I've always enjoyed playing the devil's advocate, so we role-played a conversation and I asked a couple of questions. My first question was, who wrote the Bible? The answers given were fair enough, and within the answers were the fact that the authors ranged from simple farmers to great kings, and the fact that the Bible had been preserved and is intact today is proof of God's divine intervention that ensured God's word survived history. Of course, my follow-up question was, how do we know that the authors were farmers and kings? Well, there was pretty much just chaos going on as everybody shouted out their answers. But, for the most part, the overwhelming majority were saying because the Bible says that they were. In fact, in a disgusting display of ignorance and blind obedience that I will never forget, my Bible teacher looked at me, gave me a thumbs down, stuck his tongue between his lips, and gave me a raspberry. Publicly ashamed of my insistence to ask the right questions to the wrong audience, I never spoke again in that class. And if anyone from my past ever asks me what started my path to atheism, I'll point them to that man and that story. I've moved past my anger at him, but the effect that experience had on me is why I can't stand the circular reasoning of Christians trying to prove the Bible's worth or accuracy with the Bible. I've actually had a similar conversation with my mom about this. She was giving me advice on some life questions, and every word out of her mouth was a Bible verse or just seek God's answers. And I told her that while I understand that she values those things as answers, it doesn't help worth a damn when I need to know what I want to do for a career, or where I need to start looking for a wife, or what I should be doing about health issues, or just any question that actually just has a real-life need for an answer. After about an hour of back and forth, I finally made her realize that if someone doesn't believe the Bible is true, you can't use the Bible to help them. This is as close as I've ever been to professing my disbelief, but that argument actually occurred over a year ago when I considered myself still a Christian. I understand the Christian desire to answer every question with the Bible, but when it's all you can offer to anyone, you have to accept that your worldview is crippled and small, and to so many others, even other Christians, worthless. It was in ninth grade that there became apparent a distinct difference in reactions by her kids to the dogma and teaching my mom held and enforced in our home. My oldest sister was the first to experience any kind of freedom, and while I don't know or care about the details, she was the first to experience anything sexual in nature, something that, of course, at that age, I was trying to figure out. She and I were throwing off some of the things that we had been taught and starting to spend a lot of time talking about life in school and whatnot. She helped me with my clothing style, she gave me advice on girls, she gave me some advice on how to get through the classes she'd gone through, etc. As I said before, I had many school friends because of her, and while they were all older and many times mom and dad would forbid me to hang out with them, other times I was welcomed along and encouraged to go with my sister and her friends to amusement parks or water skiing or something along those lines. I spent a lot of time with that sister, and it helped me to see her shunning some of those rules and outright breaking others. Of course, to act as a polar opposite, my middle sister was the goody-two-shoes of us kids. Whether it was classic middle child syndrome or not, she was always the one that told on us when we did something wrong. For example, my oldest sister was driving us to the grocery store, and we listened to some secular radio station for 10 minutes of the trip or so. We got home, and immediately my middle sister just went straight to my mom and dad and told on the other two of us, and of course we got in trouble. And it was always little petty stuff, and never grievous crimes against our parents or religion. I know she was striving for attention all the time, and she didn't get the wit and the humor that my oldest sister, my dad, and I have. And while I never got the full story, I know that there was a period of deep depression when she was about 14, and I think that might have affected her pretty much forever after. It was manifested by severe dedication to schoolwork, strict adherence to my mom's rules, and blind faith at church, where she was considered a spiritual leader amongst the young people. Needless to say, but I'll say it anyway, she and I never really got that close, and while I love her as my sister, I despise what I see her continuing in the raising and education of her children. Flipping through my journal entries beyond ninth grade, I didn't see many standout moments until my junior year in high school. Life was pretty much just life for a period. I got my driver's license, started watching less TV, and hanging out with my two close friends from church as much as I could. I worked in the produce department at a grocery store, and other than the occasional sit-down with my mom so she could read the liner notes and lyrics to the music I was buying, that is, the music she didn't know I was hiding in my sister's boyfriend's truck, nothing really happened. Looking back, though, I can see the clouds on the horizon, and I can feel the electricity in the air. The storm was coming.